our Bibles to Exodus. That was a little mini sermon there, so you guys had to put a little extra in the offering plate because you're getting two this morning. Exodus chapter 3, verse 1. I mean, you guys like it when we just share our... It's good sometimes to share our hearts, isn't it? Amen. Amen. I love just sharing my heart. Just sharing my heart sometimes. I might have had to do that. Do like a sermon ever so often where I just... There is no scriptures preset. There is no notes. Just share my heart. Amen. Sometimes that stuff turns out to be the best. Exodus chapter 3, verse 1. It says, "Now Moses kept the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law, the priest of Midian, and he led the flock to the backside of the desert and came to the mountain of God, even to Horeb. And the angel of the Lord appeared unto him in a flame of fire out of the midst of a bush, and he looked and beheld the bush burned with fire, and the bush was not consumed. And Moses said, I will now turn aside and see this great sight while the bush is not burned. And when the Lord saw that he turned aside to see, God called unto him out of the midst of the bush and said, Moses, Moses. And he said, Here am I. Does that sound familiar to anybody? The here am I? Amen. It's amazing how the Bible just kind of links together with stuff. Amen. And he said, Draw not nigh hither. Put off thy shoes from off thy feet, for the place whereon thou standest is holy ground. Moreover, he said, I am the Lord of thy father, the God of Jacob, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. I said Jacob twice, didn't I? The God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. And Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look upon God. And the Lord said, I have surely seen the affliction of my people, which are in Egypt, and have heard their cry by reason of their taskmasters. For I know their sorrows. And I am come down to deliver them out of the hand of the Egyptians, and to bring them up out of the land into the good land, and a land unto a land flowing with milk and honey, unto the place of the Canaanites, and the Hittites, and the Amorites, and the Perizzites, and the Hivites, and the Jebusites." It's a lot of ites there, amen. "Now therefore, behold, the cry of the children of Israel is come unto me, and I have also seen the oppression wherewith the Egyptians oppress them." Father God, right now, I pray that you lead and guide me in every way, shape, and form, Father. I pray that your power come down and you give me exactly what you want me to preach this morning. You touch us, you help us. You let us be everything that you want us to be. Let the words penetrate the hearts and let them be exactly what you want them to be. We love you and we praise you, Father. Thank you for all that you do. Have your way in this place. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. You guys can be seated. Amen. We've been talking about hearing the voice of God. Amen. Those of you who seen my video on Facebook yesterday, we're starting a new series. Amen. The other one was called Can You Hear Me Now? And in that series, we talked a lot about different ways that God speaks to us. You know, we have the Logos word, we have the Rhema word, we have the, He'll speak to us through creation a lot of times. You have the audible voice, and which may fall into one of the Rhema or Logos words, maybe. But, this, we're going to start looking at some instances other than Samuel about when God speaks. And we may see some similarities. You guys remember when Samuel said, here am I. Here it is again, Moses. Amen. And he's saying, here am I. Also, amen. Two men, amen, that turned out to do great things, amen, that brought God's presence, God's will into action. Both of them God spoke to, and both times they said, here am I. They were making themselves available. See, Samuel didn't really have a choice to be available. His mom threw him right in it. Said she made him available. She lent him to God. We talked about the word lent, and the word lent was basically make him available if needed. Amen? And of course, God took the availability and used him mightily. He was the one that anointed Saul. He was the one that anointed David to be king. David, a man after God's own heart, one of the most well-known kings that Israel ever had. Amen? Now here's Moses. You guys have heard the story of Moses. Amen? God was getting ready to use him to do a big work, a big mighty thing to bring his people out of captivity. And what is he saying? Here am I. Let's talk about some history of Moses. Moses, amen, he was the one. He was the one that was in the that was abandoned. His mom put him up so he wouldn't be killed. They were killing all the firstborns, so his mom put him in a basket. Amen. And Pharaoh's daughter, I think it was, or sister or something, picked him up and brought him and raised him up into the. There with the king, but had his mom to help raise him. Amen. See, God uses people that are unlikely. Amen. Yeah, I strive to be perfect. That's my goal, is I want to try to be perfect. Amen. I put dry, but I can't be perfect. Neither one of us are. So guess what? We're an unlikely source for God to use. Amen. Because we can't be perfect. We're going to tank it. We're going to mess up. Amen? We're going to fail. We was talking about Peter last week. He failed. He was a failure at times. He was rash. He cut the servant's the servant of the high priest's ear off because he acted out. He was rash. It's just, you know? He reacted without thinking. Some of us, we do the same things. We react without thinking. We're rash. We're imperfect. But see, God takes the unlikely and uses them in a mighty way. Now Moses had ended up killing someone and ran. Amen? Ran for his life. He ran into Egypt. And he was in Egypt. He was working there in Egypt. And all of a sudden the Lord spoke to him. Amen? And what I liked as I was reading them through this before I prayed, it says, I have surely seen the affliction of my people which are in Egypt. God's people are afflicted a lot of times. Amen? God's people, we allow ourselves to get afflicted a lot of times. We allow ourselves to get down. We allow ourselves for the weight of the world to come and just weigh upon us. We allow that a lot of times. We allow the devil to put chains on us that weight us down. It ain't possession, but it's oppression. Amen? Amen? The devil will come, or his demons will come, and they will try to get things at you. And they'll just weigh you down and weigh you down and weigh you down. It could be something as simple as, well, Pastor didn't ask me to take up the offering today. It could be something as simple, well, Charity leads most of the songs, why can't I lead something? It could be something as simple as, well, nobody hardly talked to me this morning. I went on back and didn't even have sausage. They had bacon this morning. They know I love sausage. Mickey Bacon's my favorite, I just want to say. But see, those things, those weights of the world, they weigh you down, amen? And we become afflicted, amen? The devil may not be able to steal your salvation a lot of times, but he'll do everything in his power, if he can't steal your salvation, to slow you down. Because he don't want you to succeed. He don't want you to be vibrant and on fire, because that's a threat to him. Amen. When the devil is fighting, you just may be a threat. And he's trying to slow you down. How many of you, I want to make you raise your hand. How many of you are a threat to the devil? I hope I am. Amen. And guess what? That may mean that we might have to go through some battles sometimes. See, if we could just understand, when the battle comes, we press in that much harder. See, that's the kind of drive that we need. when the battle comes, amen, when we're tired and we don't feel like coming to church, amen, or we might, amen, we could go, but we might just be just kind of not feeling good, amen. See, that's part of raising the standard. What we're, amen, what our word for this year was, standard, as in raising the standard. See, that's part of raising the standard, is when we don't feel like it, we still do. It's a higher calling. Amen. We're not normal Christians. That's a higher calling. We're not normal. Quit thinking you are. Man, I sound loud this morning. You're not normal. See, me and Charity, we've talked about this before. See, a lot of times we would love to just be able to come into church kind of late a little bit. And we used to. As youth pastors, didn't we? We lived like 7 minutes away from the church and we was late. But I had a spiritual mom. I didn't agree with her. I didn't. And I still can't say she's completely right. But you know what she told me? She pushed me to have... She pushed me to have a higher standard. She told me, she says, you're the youth pastor of this church. I'm not picking on Ricky saying this. I'm just using my own instances. You're the youth pastor of this church. You need to be here every time. Am I lying? Church become a stress relief for me. Work couldn't get a hold of me on my cell phone at church. So I wanted to stay at church just as long as I could. Amen. But that fed, that started a pattern inside of me that started a drive and fed a drive. Amen. I got to where I enjoyed church. Amen. Yeah, it was a stress relief in the beginning. Amen. But it got to where it was a drive. Amen. Me and Charity has talked about this before. Amen. It would kind of be nice to just be, hey, I ain't feeling that good. I like to sit home. But we're not normal. We're not normal Christians. We can't do that. We can't just stay at home because we don't feel good. Why? Because we got a responsibility and we got a high calling. Amen. You guys have a high calling. You have a high calling. You can't stay home every time you got a little headache. I know this is hard, guys. Listen, that ain't in the notes. You can't stay home like that because you got a high calling. God's got something for you to do. Do you want to do this or not? Then work, let perfection be your goal. Work like a pro, not an amateur. If most of you guys attended work like you attend church, where would you be? Some of you guys miss, don't let nobody know why you're not here. What would happen if you did that to your job? Didn't call in, I'm just not going to work today. See, what we're going to do, we're going to start 2 weeks vacation. Just take 2 weeks off. Everybody go on vacation at the same time. No, I'm kidding. I don't mean to be hard, but I want you to understand, guys, it's time to step up. Amen. Amen. Our word for this year is standard. It's a high calling. Amen. You can't be like everybody else. Listen, this ain't popular preaching, but this is true. Amen. See what Moses did? See, God had a purpose for Moses. He was working even when he wasn't hearing the voice of God. Amen? He was working even while he wasn't hearing the voice of God. And he was doing hard work. He was being a shepherd. He was doing work that was preparing him for his position in the future. See, it's time we step up and say, hey, I'm going to go the extra mile without anybody telling you to do it. See, we, when we're raising up kids, we get to wondering sometimes because as they get older, they seem immature a lot of times. And we wonder if they're ever going to get it because they don't go the extra mile. They won't clean their room unless you ask them to. They won't take out the trash if you ask them to, even though you've told them time and time and time and time again. Every week on Thursday, they take the trash out. But still yet, they never come home on Thursday and say, hey, Dad, I think I'll take the trash out for you. Never. You ever think God has that mentality with you? That maybe he would love for you to say, God, I'm going to spend 2 hours right now for you. I'm going to sit down and I'm going to read my Bible for an hour just for you. Just for you, just because I love you. And because I want to hear from you. It's raising the standard. Amen. It's going above and beyond. I'm going to get off that now. This message ain't going nothing like what I had planned. The people that God's people get afflicted. Amen. The Bible says, ask and ye shall receive. It says, ask and ye shall receive. Sometimes we don't ask. But if we do, he'll hear your cry. Amen. Now listen. The more you sacrifice, the more he's going to bless you. We've talked about it over and over again. We've got to get that in our minds. And God will come down and deliver them. It says he'll take them, bring them up out of a land into a good land and a large, into a land flowing with milk and honey. Amen. If we would ask God to bring us up out of our affliction, up out of the things that we're going through, he'll bring you up out of a large land. Up into a large land, into a good land, a land flowing with milk and honey. You know what that says to me? Amen. A land that will sustain my needs. Amen. It will sustain my thirst and it will sustain my hunger. Because I've asked and he's heard my cry. How many of you cry out over your needs? How many of you cry out? You don't have to have some pastor praying over you all the time. Listen, I'm glad, I'll do it. I'm happy to do it. It's part of my job. But you can ask him yourself. Yeah. And he will bring you out. I'm not saying don't call me. Please call me. But understand, we have power over the enemy. It says in Luke, for I give unto you power to tread on serpents and over all power, serpents and scorpions and over all power of the enemy, and nothing shall by any means harm you. We have power. And the Lord will sustain you. Now listen, I like this part. This wasn't in the notes either. But it's amazing how the Lord shows you things as you're reading stuff. It says, right after he says, unto a land flowing with milk and honey, it says, unto a place of the Canaanites and the Hittites and the Amorites and the Perizzites and the Hivites and the Jebusites. You know what that says to me? Yeah, it's a land flowing with milk and honey, but there's going to be opposition. Listen. It wasn't no cakewalk. They didn't get to just walk in. Hey! You know, Jason Crabb wrote a book, amen. There's talking about, amen, his ministry, what they did to get up to where that they are as the Crabb family. And people, they want to just walk into the calling, amen, into the blessing without the work. Listen, it takes work to be a Christian. It takes work to be the high calling. But the rewards are out of this world. You can't just walk into the high calling and not ever sacrifice anything. You guys don't know what I've sacrificed to be where I'm at. And I'm not saying I'm the world's most sacrificial person, but you don't know even what Billy Graham or T.D. Jakes or any of you don't know what they've sacrificed. They've gave up things to be where they're at. You want to be used for God? You want to be in a place for victory? You've got to give up something. And see, many of us may still be in the affliction because we're not willing to give up anything. We're too happy. Apparently, we're not sick enough of our circumstances because we're not willing to give up what it takes to get out of it. It ain't in my notes. Thank you, Lord. God knows what you're going through. Listen, some of you may not. God has given people spiritual discernment. Amen. Thanks to the good Lord and through the good Lord, I can look at some people sometimes and I can tell that they're going through things and that they're having a rough time. You can try to hide it, But see, what's one of my key things is to build relationships here. And if I'm around you long enough, I will see it, because I can tell, amen, when you're out of sorts a little bit. When something's different, you're not quite up to yourself. I can see it. It sticks out. The Lord shows me. Amen. There's other people with spiritual discernment. Amen. And you see it. Quit trying to hide it. The Lord sees the oppression. He sees the things that you're going through. He sees it. He sees it. But what are you willing to give up? What are you willing to give up? Amen. Let's all stand. I had about three more pages of stuff. Three and some, but I'm going to stop right here. It's a good message, too. I just want y'all to know that. It was good. I even had a cool title. Listen, guys, sin is sin. Black is black, white is white. Amen. There is no in-between with God. The Bible says, you may think, well, Pastor Brad, certain things don't say in the Bible. I don't know quite what to do. Listen, there's so many different ways that God can speak to us. Amen. He can speak to us in a word. Sometimes it's inspired words. Sometimes he can give you word through somebody else. But you seek him, you will find the answer. Amen. Sin is sin. Godliness is godliness. Amen. If you're this morning, if you're trying to get by with something under Christ, it ain't going to work. Amen. It ain't going to work. I remember when I was young, Mom and Dad had my Christmas presents stuck in a closet. They wasn't home. And guess what? I thought it was a prime opportunity. I felt bad. I only seen like one thing, I think it was, one or two. But they was all in there that they had, and I felt bad. I felt bad. I didn't go through it all and rummage it, because I was a pretty good kid, despite what Mom and Dad thought. Mom come home. I didn't even touch anything. I just opened the door of the closet and looked, and opened the door of the room and went in there. Mom told Dad, she said, he's been in there looking at his Christmas. So Dad calls me in there. Now listen, my dad's a good-sized man. When he whooped you with the belt, it was folded down once, folded down again, nice and handheld size. Amen. He called me in there. He said, son, did you look at your Christmas presents? I said, no. Now listen, Dad was a trusting dad. He wanted to believe me. Amen. He wanted to. He wanted to believe me. And he wasn't sure himself. He wasn't sure himself. He asked me a second time. He said, did you look in your Christmas presents? No. It took about three licks for me to fess up. Then I got whooped for doing it. But see, Mom had staged the door to where she knew if I'd been in it. And she knew that I'd been in it. And I had to accept my punishment, because I went the wrong way. And I made bad choices. A bad choice. Amen. There's times where I made bad choices in my life. If it wasn't for the grace of God, I've made such bad choices. If you guys knew all of the bad choices I made, you might not would even want me to be your pastor. Because I'm unworthy, except but through grace. I'm unworthy except through grace. You may be in your life going through some things. You're trying to hide from God. Listen, sin is sin. It's sin. Don't try to justify it. If you're trying to justify it, that's a good cue right there. You don't need to be doing it. Sin is sin. Know that it's sin and quit doing it. God's got a purpose for you, and he cannot use you to the fullest if you're not living for him. Amen.
It's time we step up and have a high calling. My boys, a lot of times, I'm trying to teach them. I say, you know, it's a kid in a kid's character to, when you present them with something that they know they're going to be in trouble with, to lie about it. I did it when I looked at the Christmas presents. I knew Dad had the belt right there. I was going to, you know, I thought I could get out of it by lying. But see, when we become the Christians under the high calling, we don't have to try to get out of nothing. Yeah, we're going to mess up and we're going to fall. But when we do, we take it. Amen. We say, Lord, I've fallen. Don't lie to him and say, hey, listen, I've messed up. Or don't lie to him and try to cover it up. God knows what you've been doing without you even telling him. He knows. You cannot hide it from him. Some things we have to work out for ourselves and find out if they're right or wrong. But he knows. And he's got a high standard. I heard somebody say not long ago that every generation the standards reduce. What would happen if we started every generation the standards started raising? What would happen? The things we watch now on TV we wouldn't have watched 50 years ago. Little by little, amen, the standards will reduce. The work ethic is not even the same. You may think I'm old-fashioned, but my father taught me you got to work. Quit making excuses. It says in the Bible, if you don't work, you don't eat. When you going to stand up and be the man of God that you need to be? A high standard. A high standard. We're not perfect by any means. But listen, by grace, we make it. God wants you to try. Go above and beyond. Go above and beyond. Dear Heavenly Father, God,